Hello, good afternoon, and thank you all for coming. I am actually overwhelmed at the number of people who are actually interested in this topic. And the paper that I presented back in Stockholm last August was actually this one, the project funded by CIRCA and the ASEAN Social Policy Network. Let's start by looking at the title of this presentation, Who Matters and Why? A Network Perspective on Sustainability Transitions in Community-Based Forest Management. Now, by simply reading at the title, you could easily identify the key concepts that I want to emphasize here in my presentation. These are networks, sustainability transitions, and community-based forest management. So I want you to keep in mind these keywords as I reveal to you through my presentation the connections, interconnections between these concepts and how we can build on a more complex idea from these. Let's first look at some statistics on the world's forests under community-based forestry. Back in 2002, a study conducted indicated that 10% of the world's forest is under community-based forestry, and this estimate increased to 28% in 2016. Now, community-based forestry includes forms of participation, or rather participatory conservation, joint management, private ownership. So community-based forestry was regarded as a manifestation of a paradigm shift from, I'm very sure that most of you also know this already, from the exploitative form of management that regarded forests as timber stocks and blamed upland communities as culprits for forest loss and degradation, to the more sustainable development agenda that popularized the concept of decentralization and bottom-up approach. Now, CBFM gained popularity, especially here in the Philippines, where we adopted it as an important policy mechanism. A mechanism to organize, empower, and sometimes co-opt communities as stewards of the forest. This happened also in many other tropical forest countries like Mexico, India, Nepal, and Indonesia, to name a few. Now, focusing more on CBFM in the Philippines, where the study was conducted, Executive Order 263 states that the community-based forest management will be the national strategy of the country to ensure sustainable development in forest lands. So here's, I just lifted this up from the policy. Here's how CBFM was defined: a production sharing agreement between the DNR and the Participating People's Organization, which we will now refer to as PLs, for a period of 25 years, renewable for another 25 years, and these PLs will be provided with tenure security and incentives to develop, utilize, and manage the forest. So CBFM is not just a one-time agreement. It actually integrates all the other people-oriented and community-based forestry programs in the country, such as the Integrated Social Forestry Program, the Upland Development Project, Forest Land Management Program, and the Coastal Environment Program. So the goals of CBFM are forest conservation, sustainable livelihood, and the forest capacity and organizational development of the CBFM PLs. Now, CBFM has been around for more than 10 years already, but many of our prominent scholars here in forestry, the Philippines, and in Asia argue that sustainable forest management still remains elusive, and there is growing evidence of its disappointing outcomes. Now, what our study did is we go back to the basics. We problematize what community means in the policy, and that we acknowledge that in the CBFM framework in the Philippines, the government, private, especially the non-profit oriented business sectors, and the civil society all play a role in forest management. And what CBFM wanted is that the government, first and foremost, would empower these communities and facilitate partnerships. Partnerships with the private companies, civil society actors, and the government. So the policy legitimizes these partnerships that were, they were there before, but they were informal. So the policy formalized these partnerships, and that means that the mutual interests were legitimized, namely the forest conservation goals, sustainable livelihood, and capacity and organizational development. So access and control to resources were also legitimized, as well as opportunities that were otherwise not accessible to the POs, if not for these partnerships. So the goal is to sustain these partnerships, sustain this legitimacy, and sustain the benefits, the desired outcomes of the CBFM. However, many of the scholars still argue that assessment of sustainability remains an important empirical challenge, such as the one conducted by Board Clinton Framework back in 2015. In addition to this, if we will look at official documents from the government, FMB in particular would say that desired conservation outcomes were hindered by the lack of collaboration among agencies. So still the problem lies not on the sustainability, not on the legitimacy, but on the partnerships. Now let's see what's the nature of these partnerships. First, well, it's really not predictable. You can anticipate the outcomes, but it's not predictable. It's unpredictable. But we tried to somehow capture that predictability, so we have a set of criteria indicators. And those criteria indicators were also used for monitoring and evaluation. It's standardized, and of course it's quantifiable, so you can monitor and track its development, and its attribute-based. So what is lacking, and we argue here in our study, that these indicators were silent on the dynamic relations. The assumption is that the sustainability cannot be reduced into these quantifiable criteria indicators alone. And we need to consider the dynamic relations of power, trust, and social cohesion. So, where does the problem lies? First, what we noticed while we're doing this research is that we have a critique of how we do assessments. The science of assessments we do today is blinded by its own positivistic bias. It inadequately captures the transformation process from which sustainability would come to emerge. It's not static, it's dynamic, it's transformative. And these criteria indicators, although very, very important, needs to be supplemented. There's ignorance of the historical context, and it limits the evaluation of outcomes to a set of predefined criteria indicators, emphasizing particular goals over the others, as some scholars would argue. Another reflection that we have is that we are obsessed by what should be, rather than what actually is. We have forgotten that in community-based forest management, we are not growing trees, but we are actually growing people. We have reduced the CBFM framework to a set of empirical, observable, quantifiable attribute-based data. We did not acknowledge its experiential nature, and that success or sustainability would come to emerge from people's interactions and relationships. So we argue here, we emphasize here with the key concept of sustainability transition. We emphasize here that time depth is therefore very significant in developing effective cooperation based on learning as participation, resulting to increasing levels of trust, expansion to include other activities, and the ability to tackle more complicated problems. So we learned that through time, and it's based on our own context and based on our own histories. So realizing this, after these reflections in the study, we still go back to the same old assessment. Why? We need to know if the two case study sites that were selected were indeed success by the conventional definition of the term success, which means that it's a function of environmental and socioeconomic benefits. And after we are definite that these are successful based on these criteria indicators, then we look at the role of social networks and policies and these successful sites. So we assessed success using the methods like vegetation assessment, soil analysis, characterization of socioeconomic benefits. And then for the role of networks and policies, we used policy analysis and social network analysis. For social network analysis, this is just a simple descriptive type of network analysis, and we did not use any statistical network tool or method here. So we characterized the type of actors and engagements in each CBFM stage, capturing that sustainability transition that we are trying to surface. And then some network metrics which I will show later. For the policies, well, we did extensive, comprehensive policy analysis. We also used political ecology, but for the purpose of this presentation, I will only discuss this, how policies define community. And from there, actually, there were a lot of critics already. So the advantage of using network perspective on sustainability transitions are here. So if you use social network analysis, you could capture the transformation process across the stages of CBFM. And doing this have also given us the opportunity to extract relational data that are otherwise not accounted for in monitoring and evaluation. So there's emphasis on the emerging pattern towards sustainability. And you can only see that pattern if you look it through time. Now, we do acknowledge the limitations of this method. It does not statistically represent CBFM in the global context. And the networks are peocentric. This limitation is inherent to the method because we could not, you know, anyway, capture the complete network. Peocentric means that we could, we only capture the linkages between the PO, the CBFM PO, and the other organizations, other actors. We did not capture linkages between it among other organizations. And we treated that data that we have as the core linkages that are significant in each CBFM stage. So again, this is very limited. I mean, the historical data is very limited. So we look at these two sites. First is the Lufanco, located in the U at the foot of the Mounts Banao San Cristobal protected landscape. The dominant land cover is vegetable farms, actually, and there are patches of natural forest and secondary forest. Compared to the next site, the Cabot Beach Basic Upland Farmers Association, it has a relatively larger area coverage, but they are both adjacent to a protected area. PBFAI is adjacent to the Quezon National Park and Binahaan River Watershed Reserve, and the dominant land cover is agroforestry, rubber plantation, ratay, and kalumbi. Here's just a general profile of the two people's organizations. Both are award-winning. We were both awarded back in 2012 by the CBFM Federation as one of the best CBFM practices. In fact, PBFAI was also awarded the Champions of Asia Pacific Forest by UNFAO. Here are some photos of the site and the products. So from the palette. Okay, now let's establish that these two are in fact successful. First, on the vegetation assessment, the diversity index is relatively moderately high, with 70 species identified, and the dominant species are fruit trees, mahogany, and niyog and ratan. There were ecologically important species cited, like nara, bolong eta, and pakipasi. That's the boundary, the CBFM boundary in Atimolan. Okay, now to the sample. Diversity index is also moderately high, with 81 species identified. The dominant species are pahutan, kape, trompeta, and gansolas. Ecologically important species that were found in the site during the transect method were white lawaan, pahutan, and bantigan. And this is the boundary of the Lutampa site in Banahaw. Soil analysis. For the KBFAI site, the acidic soil of the site indicates that the area is previously forested. Soil organic matter is above the desirable content of 5%. And it's efficient enough for crop growth. Carbon nitrogen ratio is also near optimal level, and soil texture indicates well-drained forest soil dominated by loamy soils. For the leaf site, also acidic, characteristic of a tropical forest, soil organic matter from the upslope most likely eroded at the bottom of the ravine due to deposition of water. And also, soil organic matter invites, encourage soil microbial activity. So the loamy soil texture of the soil in DEU may be supported that it is close to a stream in a forest location. So in summary, we will look at the vegetation and soil analysis. Both sites have moderately high plant diversity, and the soil is optimal for plant growth. We compare this to benchmarks from secondary literature, as you can see in the table. So according to our forester teammate in our project, the results of KBFI can be due to the various agroforestry projects implemented in the site. While Lufanco could be true to the protection of the remaining natural forest patches from the Mount Manahaw landscape. So let's look at the socioeconomic characteristics of both CBF and PLs. It's too small to recognize, but what we accounted for here, what we mean by socioeconomic characteristics, is that the members of the PO benefited from the various livelihood programs, from the different organizations that initiated and implemented these programs. For example, it has additional household income, additional skills. It became a source of fiber and food for household consumption. So what we see is that 85% of the total livelihood projects implemented in Cavite BC provided additional household income to the PO members. 46% of the total livelihood projects also from in KBFAI are still in operation, which is how we very superficially and specifically define what sustainability means here in this table. And 61.5% of the total livelihood projects also in KBFAI were effective, according to KS. Now, how did we get this data? Basically, this is one of the limitations I was talking about. We don't have data for monitoring and evaluation, so we invited them in a focus group and interviews. Basically, we did triangulation of data. So what we get from these livelihood programs? First one, they say that livelihood programs are successful if there's ensured market demand, resource materials are locally produced and sourced, and that if the PO capitalize on the unique features of the place. For example, there is a falls, a Bantakay falls in Atimonan, and PO capitalize on this falls for tour guiding. In the case of Lufangco, they gather wild beans with a permit in the Mount Badao San Cristobal protected landscape. So the question now is, are these CBFM sites successful? If we will simply follow the criteria indicators that we set ourselves that are actually based on secondary literature and policies, then we would say yes. Simple as that. Now, having passed our screening that this is actually successful, we look at the social networks. Now, how did it look like if we paint an image of the social networks? So again, we look at the different types of nodes, the different types of engagements or linking lists. We compute for density, that is the total actual links over total potential links, and the degree centrality, which is very simply, it's just in degree and out degree measures. In degree means that the link is towards the ego, out degree means that the link is from the ego. Okay, let's see first in the case of public BC, who's connected when. Across the CBFM stages, most of the linkages were initiated by government agencies and international NGOs. The LGU, the PO, other POs, and local NGOs began linking during the planning stage and increasing number during the implementation stage. Linkages with private organizations, on the other hand, and the academy begin during the planning stage and maintained until the implementation stage. How does this look like? It looks something like this. So basically, there's an increase in the number of actors and number of conditions. To have a better view, I dedicated a slide for this. So the network expanded in terms of the increasing number and diversity of actors and types of engagements. The increasing linkages and number of actors indicate that the people's organization became exposed to more institutions and the resources available and accessible in the network, hence accounts for efficiency in resource mobilization. Network performance, on the other hand, that is in terms of the number of projects initiated by the people's organization improved when the PO started to partner with NGOs and other POs. So what we see here is that the government only functions as a facilitator. So the pattern is that less support came from decentralized government agencies as from the preparatory to planning to implementation. In the PAMCO, again, the government agencies are dominant in during the preparatory stage. NGO connected beginning the planning stage until and they stayed until the implementation stage. While the LGUs only came into picture during the implementation stage. So this is the how the network graph looked like. So you can probably question why, what is this? LOVE is an NGO based in Mount Banahaw. So through LOVE, the LUPAMCO was connected to other POs and other international NGOs that are otherwise not connected. We will answer this question per stage of the CBFM. The network graphs would tell you that during the preparatory stage in KBFAI, the anarchistic party of Lucena was the most influential one. Influence was based on the number of LPD or the LPD measure. Again, LPD is away from the ego. So the number of projects initiated by the VNR in the CBFM site. And then in the planning, we have again the international NGOs, and during the implementation, the influential actors remain to be the government agencies, and the party will be CBFM. For LUPAMCO, government agency, the DNR-4A, is the most influential one during the preparatory stage. During the planning is LOVE, the NGO I pointed out earlier. And during the implementation stage, again, LOVE remains one of the most influential, together with DNR-4A and FD. So what we get here, although these are only two sides, what we get here is that there's no uniform story between the transition of CBFM towards sustainability. So we also looked through the time before CBFM was implemented. So the communities in CBFM were pre-identified and organized by the DNR. There were no organizations before. The observed pattern is that upland farmers in the buffer zones of protected areas were organized into POs. During the preparatory stage, the DNR facilitated and implemented projects on organizational development. During the planning stage, projects were mostly on forest conservation, protection, coupled with livelihood opportunities, and during the implementation stage, this is where infrastructural projects take in, where the PO can fund their own projects. Now, we argue here that this is still a passive form of participation. I'll delve into that later on. So, there's another way of visualizing all of that data I presented in several slides. In just one side. So you can see the evolution of the network from the preparatory to planning to implementation, as well as the type of ties, which ones are the dominant ones. So for both KBFAI and the PAMCO, of course, the dominant ones were on forest protection and management. The type of actors, for KBFAI, the dominant ones were during the preparatory where the government and since planning until implementation, it shifted to the NGOs. You can have a similar analysis or interpretation of data if you look at Lucarco. Okay, now let's briefly look at the in-degree measure here. The in-degree measure is basically the number of self-initiated, or the RPG, the number of self-initiated projects in only KBFAI only initiated their own projects during the planning and implementation stage. So yes, there is during the PCBFM and preparatory stages, there's passive participation in earlier interventions, and these interventions are initiated by the central government and international funding institutions. There's a misfit of the implementation design. I did not really detail how many of the livelihood projects I projected here earlier were failures, but there's a misfit of implementation design to the local context. And during the planning and implementation stages, this is the time where the PO learn to negotiate their own needs with different government and non-government entities, influencing their decisions and actions and policy management. So the network of social relations that we see during the implementation stage has emerged from the decades of negotiation, accumulated learned experiences, trust and connections to key people in the government, NGOs, and the private sector. So basically, there is trial and error, and again, we cannot predict the outcome of these partnerships, although we can anticipate. So what we can get out of this is that the creation of a successful community is a product of resilience and sustainability of social relations and arrangements, and trust among members of the people's organization. So success is not defined by a group of forest resource dependent people who initially share similar interests, but are determined by a network that has evolved through a decade of challenge partnerships. Those who stayed, who actually matter. Now let's go to the fun part, more fun part. For government institutions, I mentioned before that CBFM is actually a manifestation of a paradigm shift where we have the government in particular have this notion that the communities, upland communities, are the culprits of forest degradation and loss. So when CBFM came, we tried to operationalize this concept of community stewardship and participatory approach by giving them tenure, communal property tenure. So the local community could, there's a premise that the local community could restore or create a new institutional arrangement to bring back that lost harmony between the people and the environment. Now, how can CBFM promote communal property ownership, for example, if it is immensely difficult to attract members to join the PO and sustain their participation? The notion of the community as a whole is grounded on the assumption that an ideal community with strong social and cultural ties has a harmonious relationship with a similarly homogeneous environment. However, reality is far more complicated simply because both local communities and the environment are highly variable and dynamic in time and space, as what this study wanted to to show. Communities are in fact internally differentiated and cannot be treated as static, rule-bound forms, because people themselves are actively interpreting the changing world around them. So now, going back to the first question, one of the most compelling limitations to any CBFM project is the immense challenge to attract members of the CBFM field. How paradoxical it may seem that the idea of CBFM grounded on the premise of the local community could restore that harmony lost between the environment and the people is so popular among the government and international funding institutions, but has otherwise been passively and other cases blindly received by the local community themselves. So for example, in KBFAI and the Franco, they started when the upland farmers perceived that when the DNR came in to organize them as a potential project, they have struggled more to define themselves as a community. Now on the second question, how could CBFM promote communal property ownership with the concept of equity is that CBFM benefits must be shared equally to individuals. When in community, sustainability is more of a product of generalized reciprocity than benefit sharing. I'll go back to this concept more, or rather, on the next slides, but further. Now, if you look at the definition of community according to the implementing rules and regulation of the CBFM strategy, this is what it will give you. I'll let you read on your own. But basically, what it emphasizes is that community means that a group of people that who exclusively occupy a defined spatial boundary. So it's not safe whether or not you share common interests, needs, or visions. What's the implication if you define a community merely by occupying a defined spatial boundary? It gives an opportunity to have a community constructed, to have a local one. Now this is beneficial to local communities whose members strongly self-identify with a set of norms, beliefs, and knowledge defining their community, such as in many cases of the indigenous peoples. But this vagueness also leaves communities, including the successful CBFM here in our study, KBFAI and Congo, struggle to create their own self-organizing community. Now, I'm an anthropologist, so I will give some insights from anthropology. So what we learned from the previous two slides that I gave is that the concept or the ideas of community have been shaped and reshaped by the outsiders, the government, and the international funding institutions. For example, again, there's emphasis on occupying a bounded spatial limit with a distinct integrated social structure and a set of shared norms and common interests. This is, I'm not saying that it's totally bad, because there's some accuracy to this. And this definition is quite convenient if you will contrast that to the definition of the market and the state that operate by means of competition and coercion. Now, if you're an anthropologist, there were ethnographic facts about the indigenous notions of community and ecological sustainability. First, many of the indigenous groups view a community as an egalitarian community. What do we mean by egalitarian? It means that it has more or less equal access to resources. There's no formalized monopolies of information and decision making. Leadership is informal and acquired through qualities such as personality, strength, intelligence, and facilitating skills. Now, generalized reciprocity, as I contrast it with social equity before, generalized reciprocity means a type of exchange that assumes that an immediate return is not expected and that the value of the exchange will balance in the long term. So you do not expect to get the benefits in the short term. So if you follow generalized reciprocity, this means that the outcomes are not measured by the number of beneficiaries. Use of RAC instead of absolute individual rights. This means that the land is not owned by people, but for example, in many of the indigenous peoples, they are owned by the guardian spirits. While it would be naive to argue that people should ask permission from the guardian spirits before utilizing the land, there are useful underlying ideologies that can be used to reconceptualize the human environment relations, such as place-based management and people as stewards, not owners. Now we've been using this word, people as stewards, but do we actually internalize it? Actually know what it means? So indigenous notions of community place limited importance on material wealth, and trust is being gained by people who stayed long enough, regardless of culture, regardless of language being spoken or its his affiliation. Now going back to a network perspective, if you remember this network, simple network graph. So what we need here is to simplify what's actually happening in the ground. Is there are, it's more like this, marketism and linkages occur between and among different types of organizations. So drawing from the results of the study, the reflections of the study, we can recommend this following. During the preparatory stage, educate the people's organization and the community about their location and the protected areas. So make it place-based, make it landscape-based. Mainstream the concept of connected networks as community of communities to address this misfit of implementation design during the planning stage. We can do this by organizing networking events. Organizing networking events that could be particularly effective in a regional scale, aligning the agenda to particular critically important environmental areas in the country. This would diversify access to resources and opportunities, designing own projects according to the features of the place. And during the implementation, so we learned that many projects fail, but partnerships remain. Field monitoring and evaluation by the implementing institutions could serve as external checks of the performance, especially in areas where government support for MNDE is sparse. So this is not the complete picture. So if we want network of partnerships, we also want a network of networks or a community of communities. And it should be landscape-based, it should be place-based. Okay, this is one of the last few slides I have. So I just wanted to share with you some of the insights I got from the conference I attended in Sweden. Katrina Brown is one of the speakers there. So she mentioned that we need to focus on these concepts and ideas. We want to move forward towards biosphere stewardship and sustainability, people power and agency. So we need to be reminded that partnerships are relationships and negotiations of power. If we want sustainability, then we need to build and sustain partnerships. Trust is being gained by people and organizations who stayed long enough, regardless of similarities of goals. The next one is place and identity. So we need to recognize that attachments to and meanings of place, the sense of place, influences people's decisions and responses to change. And then this one, very important, perspective taking. In contrast to the rationalization of nature, where we assign tangible, quantifiable values to the environment, a new look at things that tackles questions about what it means to be human and to be vulnerable. Vulnerable to poverty, impacts of forest loss and degradation, climate change, or negative impacts of neoliberal policies. Connecting the people with the non-human world and recognizing the central role of emotions in partnerships. There are just a few scholars and literature about this, the centrality of emotions in partnerships. Next one is practice. We need to expand the methods in sustainability assessment. As I've pointed out, some of the limitations of the highly positivistic criteria and indicator-based assessments. We need to capture the historical context and sustainability transitions through the lens of networks. And we need to do this in the context of rapid change. So finally, she mentioned that we could arrive at sustainability if we have these imagined orders. By this, she means that there's a collective shared set of principles, there's a shared network of stories, and we are aware that we are no longer in the immature Anthropocene, and we are going towards conscious, mature Anthropocene. By that, she means that we are aware of the impacts of our own projects and interventions. Ghana relates that we don't know that we're going to cause climate change because of greenhouse gas emissions. Okay. Very briefly, because I still have some time left. First, how we did social network analysis. So first, we tried to get as much secondary data that we have, and basically triangulate that with key informant interviews, focus group discussions, and archival documents. For example, what I mean by archival documents is that certificates from this event, this training that the PO attended. So we visualize these networks using an open access software, or rather an add-in in Excel called Node Excel. It's freely available online. I guess that is all. And this is the team. Dr. Rico Angal is Associate Professor at CESAM, UTLD. So, and Ayesha is Research Assistant, and Roel is actually my brother in forestry. So he did the vegetation assessment and soil analysis. Thank you.